I'm Brooke Lee, and this is Modern Wahine Hawaii. Welcome to Modern Wahine Hawaii. We're here at the beautiful Hawaii Convention Center, and I'm with Dr. Christina Wang, who is with H3RC. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Let's go ahead and take our masks off because we are socially distanced. And hi!
Hi!
So Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center, my fave, let's talk about what you do there because you are the medical director. And what exactly does the medical director do?
So Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center, H3RC, really focuses on a population that's very underserved. Most of our folks are houseless or marginally housed, and many of our patients are living with HIV/AIDS, hepatitis C, and other infectious disease-related issues.
And so because you say that it's underserved communities, you guys have to kind of meet people where they are, as they say, correct?
Absolutely.
They don't come to an office.
Yes.
You have to find them where they're at. Can you talk a little bit about that?
So you're right, meeting people where they are. While we do have a physical office in Kaka'ako, which has a clinic, we run a street medicine program where we physically go out and meet people, both literally and figuratively. As you mentioned, meeting people where they are is a harm reduction principle, which we embody. And that means we know we need to get out in our community and meet people in the location that's easiest for them to access, best for us to get out and test folks so they know their status, for their HIV status, Hep C status, make sure we're getting them linked into care, and really providing hopefully more wraparound services for our patients in the community.
And so I hear you guys just got a new van.
Yeah.
Which is amazing.
Thank
because
you.
It kind of helps you guys reach further, I guess, into the community because you have all of the services right there in the van, right?
Yes. So that's our medical mobile unit you're referencing, or our MMU. So we took lessons learned from running a street medicine program in Chinatown for the last 6, going on 7 years, where we just took a rolling wagon. We did walking street outreach, looked at different models across the country around what worked in communities, and offered advanced wound care services and testing in the field. And now we'll be able to expand on those services by having a vehicle that gets us into other communities we traditionally haven't been able to serve. We'll also be able to offer other services now through telehealth, like behavioral health and mental health connections, as well as some other substance use services, and then of course PrEP, which I'm looking forward to chatting with you about pre-exposure prophylaxis for HIV.
Yeah, because we're now entering into almost 40 years since the first diagnosis here in the islands.
Right.
And it was a pandemic back then, we're in coronavirus coming out of that as well. And it's still, there's no cure.
That's right.
It's really about prevention.
Yes.
And it's about educating yourself and getting tested. And so PrEP really gives people a whole new sort of arsenal for them to use as they're out there living their lives. Do you want to talk about PrEP?
Yeah, great. So, while we're so thankful to the medications we have now, antiretroviral therapies, and being able to do what we call rapid ARTs for persons that have been diagnosed, obviously the biggest goal is to prevent the diagnosis of HIV. So PrEP has been a game changer for us in the community because, people might come in, they're unsure of their status for HIV, they get tested, but they still have a lot of those worries and the anxieties, and we talk about high-risk behavior. And one way to mitigate some of those high-risk behaviors is to start there's two medications available right now, but it's a one pill once a day option that helps prevent HIV. So we're very lucky to have that in our toolbox these days. And that also gives better comprehensive care to patients because they have a place to go to get sexually transmitted infection screenings, talk about some of their other health, get them engaged in other aspects of care that they might not have thought about had they not come in for PrEP. So we use it kind of as a no wrong door approach. That you're coming in for one service and you want to learn about that, but here's a whole host of other services that might be in your wheelhouse.
Right. And so have you seen any sort of changes through the years of how people have been perceiving their HIV status and their behaviors and how they're interacting in the communities?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think yes, definitely, because we know now when persons are diagnosed with HIV that it's no longer a death sentence. It's considered a chronic disease at this point, and I think that's wonderful. So we can teach people how to learn to live with the disease and not have it really define them and make them all about that disease.
Right.
And, you know, with one daily medications now available, instead of having to take cocktails, large combination of medications, it's really made quality of life improvements for folks. So just like diabetes, you know, is considered a chronic disease, right, mm-hmm. that you have to manage, so is HIV now. We know you can live a long, healthy, productive life. And for those that are still, engaging in some higher risk behaviors for HIV, we have that discussion about risk reduction and PrEP, and also PEP, which is post-exposure prophylaxis, being in our toolbox to help people prevent the spread of HIV. And it's also been an option for what we call discordant couples, where maybe one partner has HIV and then the other person doesn't. So we're able to kind of offer more services across the board. And we're also really encouraged to know that U equals U, which means undetectable, means untransmittable. So we have really good control of our HIV, and our viral load is not detectable. We know we're not spreading it to other people as well.
Got it. And that's just, I mean, in 40 years, I mean, that's an amazing, you know, turnaround to be able to say that at the beginning of this whole situation, it literally was a death sentence, whereas
that's
now,
right.
It's a manageable disease, and if you're educated and you're able to get to the services, you can live a long, prosperous life. So where can people find you?
Please visit us at our website at hhhrc.org, and now we're excited to launch the /MMU for our medical mobile services, so hopefully we'll be coming to a community near you.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for all the work you do in the community.
Thank you.
We're very lucky in Hawaii to have you guys here, so thank you.
Thank you.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii. I'm here with Malulani Orton, who is with H3RC. Hi, Malu.
Aloha.
Let's go ahead and take our masks off. We're socially distanced. How are you?
Super happy to be here with you, Brooke. Thank you for inviting us.
We're so excited to talk about all of the wonderful things that H3RC is doing. Let's start with how long you've been with the company.
I can't believe it's been 11 years.
Wow.
And it's been quite the evolution from the time of Life Foundation as it merged with Chow Project to become the Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center. Many more services offered than before, so I'm more energized than I was the day that I walked in.
And so as a case manager, what exactly do you do with the company?
It's a really good question. It depends upon the status of the person who walks in the door. There are a lot of people that will approach us for services who have already received an HIV verification and have already established services. But it runs the gamut too on those who have just found themselves to be positive. They're very scared, they're very concerned, they don't know where to go. And then all of the establishment of HIV 101, learning the basics, linking up with a really terrific doctor, getting those medications, and learning how to live with and getting the support to thrive.
As a case manager, you don't only deal with the patient themselves, but it really is about the support system that is around them and the family. It's a family diagnosis, really, mm-hmm. which leads me to my next question, because, you know, ohana is a big deal here in Hawaii, but you really do work strongly in the Native Hawaiian community. Can you kind of lead us through what the diagnosis and prognosis is in the Native Hawaiian community and how H3RC is in the Hawaiian community?
It's really a sad statement for our host culture. I am Kanaka Maoli too, and I look at a lot of our other health concerns. So just like we've noticed during COVID, if you've got diabetes, if you have hypertension, if you have obesity, if you are smoking cigarettes, that's not a good thing.
Right.
And it's just compiling one thing on top of the other. So there's the health status, mm-hmm. the pre-existing health status, but I think even more so is stigma. And shame that really afflict our community in ways that a lot of people were taken aback by when I first started back in 2010. And what was very striking and so tragic is a lot of Native Hawaiians at the time were finding out their diagnosis, not as HIV, but as AIDS. And in the emergency room, in intensive care, and with some other kind of comorbidity going on. Mm-hmm. When you dive deep into that and you can see it's a very complex group we belong to. So there may be ohana that are very supportive. And tragically, there may be some ohana which will not want anything to do with that person. The program that I am so proud to represent here today with you would be Keolopono. And it's a smaller group within our case management group that allows for the support of other Native Hawaiians who understand what it was like to be diagnosed, what it means to be Hawaiian and having that family, whether it's Hanai or your Koko family. It's so important to have that support. And for us as people, it's very difficult, if not impossible, to do things on our own.
Right. I mean, we're just wired to be...
We're wired that way.
...in a group and a community experience. And when that falls away for whatever reason, it affects you, whether it's by health or your mental health or what
Absolutely.
Have you. So education, I guess, is key. And in 11 years that you've been there, have you seen sort of a turning of the tide with the perception in the Hawaiian community? Or
I think, Brooke, that it remains as complex as it ever was. You're going to have some cases where you are just relieved, breathe a sigh of relief because the family has enveloped their family member, that they understand the education of it. And unfortunately, our work is not done. We'll still continue to see some of the cases out there where that family member who is diagnosed is not going to be receiving support from that family. And Keolopono coming in as sort of that surrogate, creating this hanai ohana to support that person, almost to fill in for family members, because I'm thrilled to see there will always be a mama of the group. There will always be a papa of the group. And welcoming the people in. And then when office hours are done or our event is over, I am so relieved to hear of these ad hoc relationships that have formed. They have their support groups. They know where to call. They know where to go for
right.
that support. So Keolopono group, pre-COVID, we were doing a lot of Circle Island tours. We called them Wahipana. And within that Wahipana, we took our core group of Keolopono and we went around the island and stopped at each spot. We talked about family relationships. We spoke about our health. We spoke about ways in which we could take care of our mental health with the stress. At this point, I'm just so appreciative that Nurse Raymond Alejo, Ponoi call him, is our community nurse. And the community nurse continues to do support groups with many of our members out on the Waianae coast, over at the beach. A lot of that information going back and forth is medical, but so much of it is cultural, so much of it is mental health. So, you know, we just sort of move with the groove, do what we can, and I really look forward to the time when we can all come back together again and do those wahipana tours again with Keolopono.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for all that you do, especially as a Kanaka Maoli, because it's like you said, we still have a lot of work to do. It's still here. There is no cure, but there's education and there is support if you want it. So,
well, thank you so much for your support, because I think a lot of people think that this has come and gone.
Right.
And I'm testament here today that says really there's a whole lot more work to be done.
Yes, especially in the community. So thank you so much.
Mahalo.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii here at the Hawaii Convention Center. I'm here with Madeline Sesepasara with H3RC. Let's go ahead and take our masks off. It's a little cooler with them off. How are you?
I am fabulous. Thank you
awesome.
For having me.
I'm so excited to talk to you about all of the work you've been doing with H3RC. Let's start with, how did you get involved with Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center?
There used to be a program called Kulina Mamo from 2003 and 2010. They were the only transgender agency in Hawaii for transgender by transgender. So when their doors closed in 2010, there wasn't any program for transgender folks. So when I came back in 2013 and I went back out to do outreach for Life Foundation at the time, before it became Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center, I noticed that all our girls that were succeeding, that were excelling, they're back on the streets, they're back in prostitution, they're back using substance use, and it got crazy. I didn't realize when Kulina Mamu had closed their door how much of an effect it had on our community. So me, along with several other transgender people at Life Foundation at the time, decided we needed to do something. And so we advocated, and our, you know, executive director at the time, Paul Grossback, was very supportive and knew that this was something needed. And so that's how Kuana Project came to light. And we pretty much do the same thing as Kulina Mamo, but because now we're Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center, we have all these different services at our clinic, so our transgender community are now more able to access other services. So I'm so grateful for Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center, and I'm just so blessed to be doing this work for 17 years. I am so passionate, and I love my transgender community.
So let's talk about, you know, where the risk comes from with HIV and AIDS awareness. Why do you think it is that the transgender community is more prevalent and at risk than other demographics?
I think it's because our, you know, because we're transgender folks, and you know, it's this stigma that that we're just prostitutes, that we're just showgirls, and that we can't contribute anymore. And so, you know, people really don't take us serious. They actually, we're so discriminated that, you know, that when we're trying to apply for jobs or trying to get some sort of income, no one's hiring transgender folks. So we need to do what we need to do to survive, and that leads us to prostitution, to doing illegal activities to survive. You know, it was so hard back in the 70s, 80s, 90s, even early 2000s. You know, all these laws that protect transgender folks now
weren't there. Right.
You know, so that's why it's harder for transgender folk to live a clean, healthy life because of how society treated us, you know?
Right.
It's very difficult. So by having these programs that really lets the transgender folks know that there's this place that, you know, that is supporting us, there's this place that we can learn and get educated. And that's what we've been doing for the last, 17 years, is educating our community and getting them involved and letting them know how important it is to find out your HIV status. And if you do have it, take care of it, because it's not a death sentence no more.
So when you're working with the community through H3RC, what are some of the services that you guys are providing for specifically in the transgender community?
Well, at Kuana Project, we provide social services for transgender girls. So we're making sure that they're getting the right doctors. It's hard for us to find adequate health care for transgender folks. We have different types of need when it comes to our health care. And so making sure that that's provided. And a lot of doctors who are, I hate to say this, who are older, are refusing to provide that service. They're like, oh, no, well, you know, I just want to do your diabetes, you know, I want to check your blood pressure, your cholesterol, but nothing to do with the transgender healthcare. When those things happen, that turns our community off, and they don't want to provide that, you know, they don't want that service. And so it's very important for me and my staff to make sure wherever we're sending our trans girls that they are being treated with respect, and they are being treated as individuals and human beings. That's all we want. You know, and it's very sad because, especially for our elders, you know, they had to deal with this from, like I said,
for a long time, all the way to the
2000s, fighting for their rights, fighting for them to just live their true, authentic lifestyle. You know, it's so important for us to do our job, and we also look for leaders in our transgender community, and we build them up because we know there's only like four of us in our program. We can't do it alone, and so it's so important to build leaders, to have them advocate for themselves, and also advocate for their trans brothers and sisters when we're not there, because we know it takes a whole village to help one person.
Right. Well, thank you for all the work that you do. it's so important that, you know, H3RC is out in the community, meeting people where they're at, but also recognizing that there is so much diversity within that community, and that everyone has an equal say and should be treated with respect.
Yeah. And you know, and I have to add one thing about my agency. I love my agency so much is because in our mission statement, they added in a sentence, you know, transgender, you know, how important it is to support transgender folks. And to me, that's something that I never found in any of my other employments that I've been with, you know? So this is amazing. So it, I love my agency so much. And they really have an understanding of how important it is for us to service our transgender folks.
Because H3RC has been at the forefront from the very beginning. And as it evolves, as all of it evolves, they've evolved. And so it's just amazing that you guys have all been doing all of this wonderful work. Thank you so much for all the work you do.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here and sharing your story.
I'm so starstruck right now, so don't mind.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Well, that's our show for today, Hawaii. I hope you enjoyed and learned as much as I did. Mahalo to Hawaii Health and Harm Reduction Center for all of the wonderful work that they're doing in the community. Mahalo to Dr. Wang and Maluleni Orton and Madeline Sesepasara for coming down and sharing all the important stories and work that they're doing with H3RC. It is so imperative that in this community, especially here in the islands, that we support each other, that we're there for each other, and that, you know, the services are out there to meet people where they are. Thank you to the Hawaii Convention Center and Terry Orton, as well as Natalie, for letting us come and shoot here. They're back open, so if you want to check them out, go to their website. We're doing great, Hawaii. We're washing our hands, socially distancing when we can. Wear those masks in large groups, and we're slowly crawling our way out of it. Take care of each other and check us out on the socials. You know, look us up on Facebook, check us out on the IGs, and email us if you've got some stories that you'd like us to check out. We're happy to look into it. Take care of each other, and we'll see you next week.